Warm welcome to all gathered together this evening for our Maundy Thursday service. The theme of the service is our Lord's Supper and how we observe it and what we think as we do it. All right. So with that, we begin singing with our confessional hymn number 434, Please Rise. Being called here this evening in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Since it is our intention to receive the Holy Supper of our Lord on this Maundy Thursday, we begin by examining ourselves, confessing our sins, and rejoicing in the forgiveness won for us on Good Friday and celebrated in the resurrection of our Lord on Easter. It is proper for us to examine ourselves, for this sacrament has been instituted for the special comfort of those who are troubled by their sins and who humbly confess their sins and fear God's wrath, as well as hunger and thirst for righteousness that fills the human spirit that only God can provide. We begin by hearing the word of our Lord in the words of the Psalm 23.
Thank you.
And now I ask you before God, who searches the heart, do you sincerely confess that you've sinned against God and deserve his wrath and punishment? Then declare so by saying, I do confess.
I do confess.
Truly, we should confess, for Holy Scripture declares, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Do you sincerely repent of all of your sins committed in thought, word, and deed? Then declare so by saying, I do repent. Truly, you should repent, as did the penitent sinners, King David, who prayed for it with a contrite heart, Peter, who wept bitterly, the sinful woman, and others. Do you sincerely believe that God, by grace, for Jesus' sake, will forgive you all of your sins? Then declare so by saying, I do believe.
I do believe.
And truly, you should so believe, for Holy Scripture declares, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And do you promise that with the aid of the Holy Ghost you will henceforth amend your sinful life? Then declare so by saying, I do promise.
I do promise.
Truly, you should so promise, for Christ the Lord says, in the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. And do you believe that through me, a called servant of God, you will receive the forgiveness of all of your sins? Then declare so by saying, I do believe. And truly, you should so believe, for Christ our Lord, on the evening of the first Easter, told his disciples, if you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto you. And in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We pray. O God, from whom come all good desires, all good counsel, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the singing of hymn number 762.
Thank you.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Exodus, the 24th chapter, as Moses again reminds the people of the bond that they have with their Lord through blood. Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the just decrees. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and the 12 pillars, according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offering and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do, and we will be obedient." And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the anthem.
Thank you.
The New Testament reading is taken from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, in the 11th chapter, beginning at the 23rd verse. As St. Paul explains to this troubled congregation just what they are participating in when they receive the Lord's Supper. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever, therefore, eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body and eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world." This is the word of our Lord. We rise and honor the reading of our Lord's Gospel. And the Holy Gospel is according to St. Mark in his 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
We hear about the institution of the Lord's Supper from the Gospel of Mark. On the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples said to him, "Where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. There, prepare for us." And the disciples set out and went into the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they were reclining at table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, "Is it I?" He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. This is the Gospel of the Lord. We join in confessing our common Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated, and we continue with hymn number 563. From Psalm 23, verse 5, we read, "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies." Here begins our text, dear friends in Christ. I heard recently that someone who had gotten something right in a Powerball from way back when, and there was $1 million on the table, was expiring. And I thought, you know, those people probably had, when they bought those tickets, dreams and plans and all sorts of things about how they were going to help this person pay off that debt, do this, do that, do all sorts of wondrous things. And the odd thing about it, they had it. And they lost it. Because they never really paid attention and turned in the ticket. Today, we're at the point in time in the Holy Week where we observe the institution of our Lord's Supper. It's the central message. And I think sometimes we have to sit back and remind ourselves just exactly what it is that we have in this thing. What is all the riches that God gives us in this thing that we call Holy Communion? What are the blessings? What are the things we should be thinking about? What are the things that happen when we participate in it rightly? And to realize all of this is the gifts of God, that He bids us to come and receive in all boldness and confidence. You know, David, when he wrote these words, you know, he had seen the ups and downs. He knew what all, you know, he had people chasing him, trying to put him to death. He had this happen to him and that happened to him. But he still had this confidence because he understood that God was with him. And there was this richness of grace that he was going to bestow upon him. And he would establish his kingdom and make it all work. So he turns and as he goes through this psalm, writing it, mentions and brings up the idea of God preparing for him this table. And this has a rich sense in the Old Testament. You know, it's about this celebratory thing that God prepares and grants to us. In the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah pictures the gathering of the faithful into heaven in the form of a great banquet feast in which there is the finest of wine, the best of cheese, the best of meats, and the richest of marrow. I know we don't eat that now, but back in the day, for the generations before us, that was a prime, you know, something you turned to because of the energy and what it gave you and such things like that. And David, when he says these words, is reminding us that God prepares for us a table that has been brought about by the work of his Son. And it all begins with this understanding, the power of God's word. You know, when we combine those words with the elements of the Lord's Supper, we receive a sign and can trust fully and completely that something is happening here beyond what we can see. Something is taking place that we grasp with faith, that we begin to understand that here is a special moment in time that happens for our benefit. And as that takes place, we are reminded, of course, and we should be thinking about the real presence of our Lord as He comes to be with us. You know, oddly enough, I had a couple of Christmas hymns this past Sunday because, well, the Annunciation of Mary took place on Monday. And that Annunciation was the announcement to Mary that she was going to have the Christ child and she was going to be the Mother of God and that He was going to assume into Himself, you know, humanity, you know, the Holy One that was going to be born within her because, as that hymn that we sang before, the time had become right. The fullness of the moment had taken place. The pregnancy of the moment was ready to be delivered. And therefore, God was going to come into this world and be with us. And He was going to assume into Himself humanity. Now, Hermann Saucy, a famous, you know, Lutheran writer, who came out of a time of rationalism and then, you know, became a steward of the faith, reminds us and wrote in one of his letters that he sent out that if the Lutheran Church loses an understanding of the Lord's Supper, it loses its identity. And here's why. Because the Lord's Supper When we look at it in our Lutheran confessions, the heart and soul about as it defines for us who Jesus is not under the article about Christ. It's under the article about the Lord's Supper, about how there's this union that takes place that can't be divided, that can't be ripped apart, and that this union takes place as God assumes into himself humanity and God the Son becomes born and is man. And because of that union, wherever his divinity is, there is his humanity. And wherever his humanity is, there is his divinity. As his divinity comes and inhabits the elements through the power of the Word and the Lord's Supper, so his humanity comes. The humanity that died upon the cross, the humanity that could not be separated at that moment, is the humanity that makes it possible for his real presence to take place. When we're observing the Lord's Supper, one of the things to remind ourselves is that here is the God upon the cross who comes to us to grant to us the next point, the forgiveness of sins. To realize and to think about that we are receiving from God a sign and a promise and a seal of our forgiveness, so that we will know for certain beyond a shadow of doubt that as these words are true, so is the forgiveness that is offered in this sacrament. And all of this takes place because and has the result of the next point, that God is with us. There is in communion this understanding that we have this relationship with God, this vertical relationship that goes up to God, and that we now can behold him and understand who he is. In the seventh grade today, we were talking in the religion class, and one of the kids we had been going through, you know, about the death of Jesus and what took place, you know, the earth shook, the rocks split open, and, you know, the dead came out, and the curtain temple was torn in two. And one of the seventh graders goes, well, that shows us that the dividing line between us and God is gone. And now we can go in and back and forth. I thought, not bad. Because that's part of what this all is all about. God being here is to remind us that he is with us and we have that relationship directly with him. And as we kneel and realize that, and we look around, we're also reminded we don't go up there one at a time for communion. We go up as a table, as a group. Communion does not belong to us individually. It belongs to us as a church, and we have a relationship with one another as the body of Christ, who to care for one another, to see to each other's needs, and to share God's good gifts with each other. This special bond that brings us together as his church is a sign and part that we think about in communion. And as we come here, as we drive over here, as we walk in, take the energy to do that. Set aside the time to be here, to forgo the basketball game. Well, KU's not in it anymore, so what big deal. But to do all of those things is part of our worship of our Lord. It's a sacrificial time in which we realize we are to give back to our Lord as he, out of the richness, has given to us. And as we do all of those things, we come to the point of understanding the richness and the fullness of those words. Luther, from time to time, would demand of his people an obedience to God's word, a recognition of it. And one of those times is in this supper that we're about to partake, where he calls upon us today, as Lutherans, following in his tradition, to recognize what those words mean, to realize what we are receiving in those words, to acquiesce and believe those words as they come to us as the power of God, who also represent for us Christ's death upon the cross, our salvation, our forgiveness, and our life with him, each other, and so much more. Because as we do that, we are receiving and are beginning to grasp the meaning of what it is that we have in the supper of our Lord. Amen. And now may the peace which passes all human understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this point in time, we will continue with the taking of the offering. We rise for the prayers. Let us pray. Our Savior Jesus Christ, God provided us with a Passover lamb to save us from eternal death when he sent you into our world and sacrificed you on the cross for our sins. Work, we pray, true repentance in our hearts, causing us to make a sincere confession of our sins and to believe with joyful trust that he has forgiven us for your sake. May your body and blood given and shed for our sins and imparted to us here this evening in bread and wine in the supper that commemorates your death ever nourish our faith, cheer our hearts, and strengthen our will to live godly and upright lives. Precious Redeemer, may your face that once reflected the burden of our sins and the anguish of hell ever be turned towards us in love and tenderness. Let no one in this Christian assembly who has known you as friend and Lord, as well as Savior, ever betray your love. And may the dear blood once shed for us be for our sins the perfect cleansing power. Hear us to the glory of your name, Holy Redeemer. Amen. We continue with the questions and answers of Martin Luther found on page 6 for those preparing to go to the supper of our Lord. Do you believe that you are a sinner? How do you know this? Are you sorry for your sins? What have you deserved from God because of your sins? Do you hope to be saved? In whom then do you trust? Who is Christ? How many gods are there?
Only one, but there are three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
What has Christ done for you that you trust in him?
He died for me and shed his blood for me on the cross for sins.
Did the Father also die for you?
He did not. The Father is God only, as is the Holy Spirit, but the Son is both true God and true man.
How do you know this?
From the Holy Gospel, from the words of the Jesus sacrament, and by his body and blood, he
What are the words of institution? Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. Take, eat. Do you believe, then, that the true body and blood of Christ are in the sacrament?
Yes, I believe.
What convinces you to believe this?
The word of Christ, drink, eat, this is my body, drink the blood of me, this is my blood.
What should we do when we eat his body and drink his blood and in this way receive his pledge? Why should we remember and proclaim his death? What motivated Christ to die and make full payment for your sins?
His great love for his Father and for me and for other sinners.
Finally, why do you wish to go to the sacrament? What should admonish and encourage a Christian to receive the sacrament frequently?
First, both command and promise Christ the Lord. Second, he will impress me, because of which commandment the Lord encouragement.
But what should you do if you are not aware of this need and have no hunger and thirst for the sacrament? And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same manner he took the cup, and when he had supped, and when he had given thanks, he gave to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of our Lord be with you always. Thank you. Please rise for the post-communion prayer. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. From John 19, verses 23 through 24, we read, "When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, 'Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be.' This was to fulfill what the scripture says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" In light of these verses, and to symbolically show the stripping of Jesus, we will strip the altar at this time. While we are doing that, we will be singing hymn number 439. Please be seated.
Thank you.
bless the Lord. The Lord bless us, defend us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Tomorrow evening, we will have our two Good Friday services. We hope to see you there. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.